We're all familiar with historical stories. We learn them from our textbooks, popular histories, movies, documentaries, and grandparents and neighbors.
If you had the misfortune to do too much of it at school, you'll probably remember one thing about history, just how boring it can be. As a result, it wouldn't be surprising if nowadays you tended to steer well clear of the whole topic. But that would be a pity. The real reason why history is so boring is that we're not clear about what it should be for. Here's the big reason why history matters. It matters because it can provide us with solutions to many of the problems of the present. At its best, history is there to introduce us to some of the things we need, but that aren't sufficiently visible in the world today. What we nowadays need, above all else, are good ideas, and history is full of them. Things can change. People haven't always been as they are now, materialistic and work-obsessed, unable to build nice architecture, over-concerned with being connected or hung up on being absurdly thin. There's an annoying saying that goes, "Those who don't know history are doomed to repeat it." But that's suggesting the only thing history is full of is mistakes. Yet it's as fair to say, those who don't know history won't be able to improve the present.
There are few events that humans around the globe owe more to than the incident that occurred on Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula some 65 million years ago. At that point in time, a huge asteroid hit the Earth, releasing over a billion times more explosive energy than the atomic bombs that hit Hiroshima and Nagasaki. This impact finished off the domination of the dinosaurs and opened new pathways in the evolutionary history of the world, and made room for our primate ancestors. The cataclysm helped humans to evolve and multiply and dominate the surface of the planet. And the site in Yucatan reminds us that big history and environmental history are intertwined. The shift from hunter-gathering to agriculture is probably the most important ecological event in the history of humanity. The agricultural revolution is a global event because it happened in parallel developments in many parts of the world, although at slightly different times. Agriculture revolutionized the way people interacted with other species, which revolutionized the way people interacted with each other as well. One of the world's great transformations in global environmental history has been the plowing up of the world's grasslands to grow grain. The process began at the western end of the Eurasian steppes, in present-day southern Russia and Ukraine in the second half of the 18th century. In the 19th and 20th century, the great plow-up spread to vast areas of the prairies and great plains of North America, the pampas of South America, the veld of South Africa, northern India and North Africa, and the plains of Hungary and Romania. This process was driven by the transport revolution, aided by the construction of railroads, cargo ships, ports and grain elevators. Facilitated by domestic and international markets, the grain was consumed by the globe's burgeoning urban population. The conversion of large parts of the world's grasslands to arable fields was achieved with great social and environmental cost. Indigenous populations were forcibly driven off the land, and their way of life, which was based on herding or hunting livestock, was destroyed. The Indian Wars of the late 19th century and the wars on the Eurasian steppes over many centuries between states based on farming and pastoralism opened the way to the plow. The plowing of the fertile soil to grow grain was also followed by ecological disasters, of which the Dust Bowl on the southern plains of the United States in the 1930s is probably the most infamous.
This is what happened, you know. This is 1854. The American Indian chief of Seattle replies to an offer from the white government of the United States to buy, in quotation, to buy a large area of Indian land. How can you buy or sell the sky, the warmth of the land? The idea is strange to us. If you do not own the freshness of the air and the sparkle of the water, how can you buy them? You don't own them. Every part of this earth is sacred to my people. Every shining pine needle, every sandy shore, every mist in the dark woods, every humming insect is holy in the memory and experience of my people. This beautiful earth is the mother of the red man. We are part of the earth and it is part of us. The rivers are our brothers. We give the rivers the kindness we would give to any brother. But the white man does not understand our ways. He is a stranger who takes from the land whatever he needs. The earth is not his brother but his enemy. And when he has conquered it, he moves on. He kidnaps the earth from his children and he does not care. I do not know. Our ways are different from your ways.
A historian, Lynn White Jr., is giving, and this is a good example of interdisciplinarity. It's a historian who is giving a speech to the AAAS in 1967. It was published in Science magazine under the title, The Historical Roots of the Ecologic Crisis. It was not until about four generations ago that Western Europe and North America arranged a marriage between science and technology, a union of the theoretical and empirical approaches to the natural environment. The emergence in widespread practice of the Baconian creed that scientific knowledge means technological power over nature can scarcely be dated before about 1850. Its acceptance as a normal pattern of action may mark the greatest event in human history since the invention of agriculture, and perhaps in non-human terrestrial history as well, end quote. Lynn White goes on to note, the sudden fusion of these two in the middle of the 19th century is surely related to the slightly prior and contemporary democratic revolutions, which, by reducing social barriers, tended to assert a functional unity of brain and hand. The consequence, White concluded, is an entirely novel democratic culture, using knowledge to increase power, with still unimaginable consequences for ecological and political environments. And he goes on to ask whether a democratized world can survive its own implications.
Although the oil well at Titusville, Pennsylvania, drilled in 1859, was not the first in the world, it was the first drilled with mechanical power, using a steam engine. This well symbolizes the shift away from a coal economy to an oil and gas dominated one. The rise of oil has had one of the most pronounced effects on world history. It made the automobile possible, a development that changed the face of the planet and drove urban expansion in a way never seen before. The long-term consequences could even be more dramatic, with the growing indications that with burning the black gold, we are altering the climate of the planet. As such, the triplet of energy history, transportation history, and climate history are taking charge of the agenda of environmental historians.
This is preeminently the time to speak the truth and boldly. The measure of that restoration lies in the extent to which we apply social values, more noble than mere monetary profit. Happiness lies not in the mere possession of money. It lies in the joy of achievement, in the thrill of creative effort, the joy, the moral stimulation of work, no longer must be forgotten in the mad chase of evanescent profit.
The end of humanity or civilization has been popular in Gothic and proto-science fiction literature since the 19th century. H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds is a good example of Armageddon unleashed on the world population. Real-world events such as the Black Death also reverberate in the environmental memory of Europe and Asia. But nothing had prepared humanity for the powers that would be unleashed during the 20th century. The mushroom clouds over Hiroshima and Nagasaki have been burned onto the retina of present-day global consciousness. The introduction of nuclear weapons into warfare has to be considered as one of the most important environmental events in human history, with its potential to wipe out and alter life across the planet. The further development of nuclear weapons since the Second World War even threatened the very existence of the human race itself. Nuclear warfare became the ultimate apocalypse and Armageddon.
The outstanding feature of the 20th century has been the enormous expansion in the numbers who are given the opportunity to share in the larger and more varied life, which in previous periods was reserved for the few and for the very few. This process must continue at an increasing rate. If we are to bring the broad masses of the people in every land to the table of abundance, it can only be by the tireless improvement of all our means of technical production, and by the diffusion in every form of education of an improved quality to scores of millions of men and women. Even in this startling hour, I have faith that this process will go on. If, with all the resources of modern science, we find ourselves unable to avert world famine, we shall all be to blame. But a peculiar responsibility would rest upon the scientists. I do not believe that they will fail. But if they do, or perhaps were not allowed to succeed, the consequences would be very unpleasant, because it is quite certain that mankind would not agree to starve equally. And there might be some very sharp disagreements about how the last crust was to be shared. As our greatest intellectual authorities here will readily admit, that would simplify our problem in an unduly primordial manner.
We now stand 10 years past the midpoint of a century that has witnessed 4 major wars among great nations. The need to maintain balance between the clearly necessary and the comfortably desirable, balance between our essential requirements as a nation and the duties imposed by the nation upon the individual, balance between actions of the moment and the national welfare of the future. As we peer into society's future, we, you and I, and our government must avoid the impulse to live only for today, plundering for our own ease and convenience the precious resources of tomorrow. We cannot mortgage the material assets of our grandchildren without risking the loss also of their political and spiritual heritage. We want democracy to survive for all generations to come, not to become the insolvent phantom of tomorrow. We pray that peoples of all faiths, all races, all nations may have their great human needs satisfied, that those now denied opportunity shall come to enjoy it to the full, that all who yearn for freedom may experience its spiritual blessings. Those who have freedom will understand also its heavy responsibility, that all who are insensitive to the needs of others will learn charity, and that the sources, scourges of poverty, disease, and ignorance will be made disappear from the earth, and that in the goodness of time, all peoples will come to live together in a peace guaranteed by the binding force of mutual respect and love.
In 1961, in what is now the South African province of KwaZulu-Natal, white rhinoceroses were first successfully tranquilized, thus enabling their translocation throughout the continent and indeed around the world. This timely intervention rescued this remarkable species from the brink of extinction to become the world's most common rhinoceros. It is a not often told story, but it has been the blueprint of many species relocations around the globe in order to save them.
Ms. Carson maintains that the balance of nature is a major force in the survival of man, whereas the modern chemist, the modern biologist, the modern scientist believes that man is steadily controlling nature.
Now, to these people, apparently the balance of nature was something that was repealed as soon as man came on the scene. Well, you might just as well assume that you could repeal the law of gravity. The balance of nature is built of a series of interrelationships between living things and between living things and their environment. You can't just step in with some brute force and change one thing without changing a good many others. Now, this doesn't mean, of course, that we must never interfere, that we must not attempt to tilt that balance of nature in our favor. But unless we do bring these chemicals under better control, we are certainly headed for disaster.
We all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's futures, and we are all mortal. Our problems are man-made, therefore they can be solved by man, and man can be as big as he wants. No problem of human destiny is beyond human beings. Man's reason and spirit have often solved the seemingly unsolvable, and we believe they can do it again.
But if a man doesn't have a job or an income, he has neither life nor liberty, the possibility for the pursuit of happiness.
If a free society cannot help the many who are poor, it cannot save the few who are rich.
We now have the techniques and the resources to get rid of poverty. The real question is whether we have the will.
Though the civil rights leaders, for various reasons, refuse or can't take a stand or have to go along with the administration, that's their business. But I'm afraid that I know that justice is indivisible. Injustice anywhere is the threat to justice. Everywhere.
through our pain, we will make them see their injustice, and it will hurt, as all fighting hurts. But we cannot lose. We cannot. They may torture my body, break my bones, even kill me. Then they will have my dead body, not my obedience.
This means greater coverage and analysis of international news, for it is no longer far away and foreign, but close at hand and local. It means greater attention to improved understanding of the news, as well as improved transmission. And it means, finally, that government at all levels must meet its obligation to provide you with the fullest possible information outside the narrowest limits of national security. And so it is to the printing press, to the recorder of man's deeds, the keeper of his conscience, the courier of his news, that we look for strength and assistance. Confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent, free and independent, free and independent.
Every country has had a violent revolution for one reason or the other. Not one of them has the freedom we're all talking about. So we're saying give peace a chance, you know, like nobody's ever done it before. And it's not a matter of, we're not thinking in terms of 10 years, we're thinking in terms of peace forever, you know. And that everybody's talking about now. I want peace now. We can get peace now if we want it now. And the left wing talk about giving the power to the people. You know, anybody knows that the people have the power. All we have to do is awaken the power in the people. The people are unaware. It's like they're not educated to realize that they have power. They put the politicians in power. They vote for the local mayor. The people do it. But the system is so geared that everybody believes that just the father will fix everything. The father being the government. Government will fix everything. It is all government's fault. You know, shake a fist at the government. Well, we are the government. The people are the government and the people have the power, but we must try and make them aware of this.
In the United States, 5% of the population have 20% of the income. And the bottom 20% have 5% of the income.
Islam, Judaism, Christianity are the three great evils that have befallen the world.
There was a time when an American who was about to go overseas would be warned not to drink the water. But now we have such a tremendous water pollution problem in our fjords and an air pollution problem also that if any of you are thinking of coming to the United States, I would suggest that you heed the warning in the following song.
If you visit American City, you will find it very pretty. Just two things of which you must beware. Don't drink the water and don't breathe the air. Pollution, pollution, we got smog and sewage and mud. Turn on your tap and get hot and cold running crud. See the halibuts and the sturgeons being wiped out by detergents. Fish gotta swim and birds gotta fly, but they don't last long if they try. Pollution, pollution, you can use the latest toothpaste and then rinse your mouth with industrial waste. Just go out for a breath of air and you'll be ready for Medicare. The city streets are really quite a thrill. If the hoods don't get you, the monoxide will. Pollution, pollution, wear a gas mask and a veil. Then you can breathe long as you don't inhale. Lots of things there that you can drink, but stay away from the kitchen sink. Throw out your breakfast garbage, and I've got a hunch that the folks downstream will drink it for lunch. So go to the city, see the crazy people there, like lambs to the slaughter. They're drinking the water. water and breathing the air.
We'll try to play all cameras. I'll play a little bit moving around here as we go along, in case you want to use it. Okay. I have sent to the Congress today a sweeping set of proposals to clean up our nation's air and water. This is the most far-reaching and comprehensive message on conservation and restoration of our natural resources ever submitted to the Congress by a President of the United States. We are taking these actions not in some distant future, but now, because we know that it is now or never.
Earth Day demonstrations began in practically every city and town in the United States this morning, the first massive nationwide protest against the pollution of the environment. In Washington, there was an awesome Earth Day warning from a government scientist. Dr. J. Murray Mitchell said pollution and overpollution, unless checked, could so warm the Earth in 200 years as to create a greenhouse effect, melting the Arctic ice cap and flooding vast areas of the world.
The European Union, as we now know it today, came about through a number of treaties, or agreements, between European countries. After the horror of World War II, people wanted to find ways to ensure future peace and cooperation between the different countries in Europe. So, in the late 1940s, the idea of a European community was discussed.
Europe can only be united by the heartfelt wish and vehement expression of the great majority.
Then, in 1951, the first union was formed between six countries: Belgium, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Italy, France, and West Germany. They agreed to work together on production of coal and steel, materials that were essential for rebuilding military forces. They felt that by working together, it would help avoid any more wars between the countries. By 1957, these countries felt the union was going so well, they decided to take things further. They set up the European Economic Community, or EEC. Soon, other countries wanted to join the EEC, and the membership started to grow.
Herds of deer graze peacefully in the African bushland, while at the other end of the world, baby seals drift lazily on the Arctic ice floes. But both are linked by the same threat, man and his greed. Since 1600, one in every 100 species of bird and mammal has become extinct, and 3% of those left alive are now under severe threat from man. United Nations Secretary General U Thant.
The total effects of changes within all countries, added together, will require joint international surveillance, consultations, and actions if human life on this planet is to be preserved and enriched.
All nature's creations are relative to each other, intertwined in an undiminishing cycle of life, death, and rebirth. Man, the innovator, is the only living organism to move away from the set cycle and create his own unnatural habitat, the city. In his drive for independence, man has moved from the shelter of nature into the artificial life of a manufactured community, a monument to superiority over nature and his vanity. But the city utterly fails as an artificial environment in at least one punishing aspect. Unlike nature, it does not replace what it uses. Instead, the city industriously goes about creating an environment of waste, useless and dangerous waste. Man is rapidly approaching the stage where, with the continued growth of these communities, his entire planet may become engulfed in a conglomeration of buildings, factories, and stinking piles of refuse. Millions of gallons of human sewage flow out of these cities with daily regularity. Much is simply pumped into nearby rivers and streams, where it combines with lethal industrial waste. Each year, more rivers are added to the list of dead waterways. The main river wrecker is industry, using colossal quantities of water and pumping back millions of gallons of toxic effluent. In the United States in 1968, more than 15 million fish died as a result of water pollution, and in Britain, more than 1,000 miles of inland waterway are seriously polluted. But industry is not entirely to blame, as more and more land is devoured by agriculture to feed the world's spiraling population. Advanced farming technology is taking a terrible toll of the environment. Chemicals such as DDT run off into streams, which carry them into the marshlands and lakes, home to much of the world's wildlife. The most dangerous feature of such chemicals is the way in which they are concentrated in food cycles. Daily, we are confronted with the effects of our complex society. As we consume nature's resources to feed our industry, these processes are in turn destroying our environment. Conservationists have warned that unless immediate measures are taken, this generation of humans may go down in history as the greatest destructive vandals of all time.
Then, as now, any country that wanted to join had to apply, and the existing members decided whether to let them join or not. The UK applied, and after being turned down twice, finally joined in 1973.
It is a step towards the participation of the peoples of our countries.
50 years ago, when the common market was born, what people wanted most was peace and prosperity for Europe. Caring for the environment didn't feature in the founding Treaty of Rome. Yet environmental problems were not far away. Europe's love affair with the car was moving into top gear. Industry was building up. By the 1970s, it was clear that minimum standards needed to be set for water and air pollution, as well as waste management.
Stockholm, Sweden, June 12, 1972. Mrs. Indira Gandhi, Prime Minister of India, arrived today to address the first United Nations Conference on the Human Environment. She was met by the Secretary General of the conference, Mr. Maurice Strong, who escorted Mrs. Gandhi to the rostrum.
It is clear that the environmental crisis which is confronting the world will profoundly alter the future destiny of our planet. No one amongst us, whatever our status, strength, or circumstance, can remain unaffected. Countries with but a small fraction of the world population consume the bulk of the world's production of minerals, fossil fuels, and so on. Thus, we see that when it comes to the depletion of natural resources and environmental pollution, the increase of one inhabitant in an affluent country at his level of living is equivalent to an increase of many Asians, Africans, or Latin Americans at their current material levels of living. The inherent conflict is not between conservation and development, but between environment and the reckless exploitation of man and earth in the name of efficiency.
Each of us all across this great land has a stake in maintaining and improving environmental quality. Clean air and clean water, the wise use of our land, the protection of wildlife and natural beauty, parks for all to enjoy. These are part of the birthright of every American. To guarantee that birthright, we must act, and act decisively. It is literally now or never. During the past 3 years, we have made a good start. We have passed new laws to protect the environment, and we have mobilized the power of public concern. But there is much yet to be done. 18 of the major environmental proposals which I put forward a year ago has still not received final action by the Congress. I repeat today my urgent request for congressional action on this much-needed legislation. And I am also presenting a number of new proposals. The environmental agenda now before the Congress includes laws to deal with water pollution, pesticide hazards, ocean dumping, excessive noise, careless land development, and many other environmental problems. These problems will not stand still for politics or for partisanship. They demand to be met now. By meeting them now, we can make 1972 the best year ever for environmental progress. The time has come for man to make his peace with nature.
If we do not save the environment, then whatever we do in civil rights or in a war against poverty will be of no meaning, because then we will have the equality of extinction.
And all of a sudden, people say, wait a second, this is not how we have to live.
Vietnam's over, and what are we going to do next? And the answer to that question was, we're going to start an ecology movement. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to go save the whales.
What we put into effect was a plan that Bob Hunter had come up with from reading a lot of Gandhi. He felt that we could just put ourselves between the harpoon and the whales, and they wouldn't kill the whales.
It wasn't just a matter of holding up signs saying, stop killing the whales. No. Greenpeace wanted to get out there in front of the whaling boats and stop them.
All the Greenpeace's a-sailin', they're crazy as hell. They'd be riding the big ocean in a hollowed-out shell. They'll probably get seasick, or they'll probably go blind. They're probably on drugs, or at least out of their minds. Now what is a whale but a big hunk of flesh? Let's poke him and stab him and steal his breath. Let's
shoot. In 1975, Greenpeace set off to hunt the whalers. After 2 months at sea, they came upon the Russian whaling fleet.
There's five over there, there's one by the Vostok, and there's three over here. There's nine chasing.
We're coming upon a floating slaughterhouse. There's blood in the water, there's huge slabs of blubber being hauled up on these big factory ships. Blood is just pouring out of this pipe, and the stench alone made us all want to throw up.
Suddenly, Bob and I were in a small boat in front of a Soviet harpoon vessel that was bearing down on us. In front of us is eight magnificent sperm whales that were fleeing for their life, and every time the harpooner tried to get a shot, I was at the helm, so I would maneuver the boat to try and block the harpoon.
Here's the whales, here's us in our Zodiacs, and here's the Russian ship. We are right between the Soviet ship and the whales. And the harpooner's not shooting, but eventually, somebody from the bridge walks down the catwalk and talks to the harpooner, and the harpooner nods and the guy goes back, and Bob looks in his eyes and he knows, this guy's gonna shoot this harpoon.
Then he looked at us and smiled and brought his finger across his neck, and that's when I realized Gandhi wasn't gonna pull through for us that day.
And at that very moment, they fire the harpoon.
This harpoon flew over our head and slammed into the backside of one of the whales, and she screamed. It was a very human-like scream, like a woman, and it took us completely off guard.
The whalers purposefully shoot at a female first because they know that the bull whales will attack them. And then when the bull whales come to attack them, which is exactly what happened,
he was waiting for him and very nonchalantly pulled the trigger and sent a second harpoon into the head of the whale, and he screamed and fell back, and now the water is full of blood everywhere from the two dying whales. And as this whale lay and rolled in agony on the surface of the ocean, I caught his eye and he looked straight at me.
And I have to tell you, It's sort of beyond emotional. You know, when there's certain moments that are so emotional,
you're just in brand new territory.
I began to think, why were the Russians killing these whales? You know, they didn't eat sperm whale meat, but they did use the spermaceti oil to make high heat-resistant lubricating oil for machinery. And one of the pieces of machinery that they used it in is the manufacture of intercontinental ballistic missiles. And I said, here we are destroying this incredibly beautiful, intelligent, socially complex creature for the purpose of making a weapon meant for the mass destruction of humanity. And that's when I came to me with a, you know, like a flash, we're insane. We're just totally insane.
Acid rain was destroying Europe's forests, and green campaigners were making their presence felt. Individual countries began to take action, and the EEC stepped in with tough new air quality laws. 50 years ago, Europe's polluted rivers also needed help. The Rhine crosses 6 countries, a source of water for 50 million people. After the Second World War, the river was little more than an open sewer. In the 1970s, Germany and the other countries bordering the Rhine, with backing from the EEC, began to clean it up, installing treatment stations and working closely with industry.
The Love Canal residents decided to do their own health study and found an alarming increase in disease and birth defects.
We truly believed if we can prove that there is an increase in disease, they, meaning the government, will do the right thing. And we found that 56% of the children in our community were born with birth defects. 56% of our children had 3 ears, double rows of teeth, extra fingers, extra toes, or were mentally retarded. During that study time, there were 22 women who were pregnant, and of those 22 pregnancies, only 4 normal babies were born. And the health department literally threw the health study on the floor. I mean, literally took it and just threw it on the floor and said, it's useless housewife data collected by people who have a vested interest in the outcome.
The New York State Health Department was prodded into doing its own health study and presented their findings to a packed meeting in Love Canal.
The health commissioner took the stage and said, we found that 56% of the children in Love Canal were born with birth defects. And we're secretly, as sick as it sounds, saying, yes, yes, and now you're gonna evacuate us, right? I mean, that's what we're hoping for. And then he says, but we don't believe those birth defects are related to Love Canal. And it's just the whole audience you could hear was, huh? I mean, it was just like, and it's like, we believe that those birth defects are related to a random clustering of genetically defective people.
I'm getting tired of them weeping. I'm getting tired of them screaming. I'm getting tired. Everybody's going to hell. There is poison in the well. Dead man downtown.
For the residents, Love Canal became a 2-year struggle to get relocated. Lois Gibbs pushed relentlessly and finally forced the state to bring in the federal government. The Environmental Protection Agency launched a pilot study of chromosome damage. The results of the tests were explosive.
Chromosome damage means my 2 children may be genetically damaged as a result of Love Canal. That was the straw that broke the camel's back.
We will then decide whether this evidence, added to the cumulative knowledge that we already have from other health and environmental studies at Love Canal, justifies a recommendation for relocation of the residents or other appropriate actions to assist those in the area.
It seems to me that the federal government has finally, after 2 years, come up to the high-level thinking of housewives that they have constantly put down. We know what's going on. We did research too. And we want out of there. We want our kids out. Not on Wednesday, today.
Jimmy Carter had a terrific energy policy. It had the goal of getting at least 20% of the nation's energy from renewable energy resources by the year 2000, and a series of proposed policies that, had they been implemented, actually would have gotten us there. He had solar water heaters installed on the White House roof.
A generation from now, this solar heater can either be a curiosity, a museum piece, an example of a road not taken, or it can be just a small part of one of the greatest ventures ever undertaken by the American people.
They tell us we must learn to live with less and teach our children that their lives will be less full and prosperous than ours have been. That the America of the coming years will be a place where, because of our past excesses, it will be impossible to dream and make those dreams come true. I don't believe that. And I don't believe you do either. That's why I'm seeking the presidency. I cannot and will not stand by and see this great country destroy itself. Our leaders attempt to blame their failures on circumstances beyond their control, on false estimates by unknown, unidentifiable experts who rewrite modern history in an attempt to convince us our high standard of living, a result of thrift and hard work, is somehow selfish extravagance, which we must renounce as we join in sharing scarcity.
You and I and other ordinary people around the world can do will not by itself save the natural world. The great decisions, the great disasters that face us can only be dealt with by governments. And that's why this organization is so important.
In 1986, a fire triggered a catastrophic chemical spill in Switzerland, which wiped out all aquatic life in the Rhine downstream for 400 kilometers. This called for drastic action, and a more tightly coordinated cross-border approach achieved near miracles. 10 years later, salmon were back swimming in the river. This integrated approach in the Rhine served as a model for current EU water legislation.
As the EEC grew in size, they worked on ways to make it better. In 1986, Margaret Thatcher signed the Single European Act, which further reduced barriers to trade between the different countries.
The Reagan White House has finally dismantled the last vestiges of the Carter administration. Workmen have now taken down the solar water heating system installed on the White House roof in 1979.
There is environmental extremism. I don't think they'll be happy until the White House looks like a bird's nest.
No generation has a freehold on this earth. All we have is a life tenancy with a full repairing lease.
It is as menacing in its way as those more accustomed perils with which international diplomacy has concerned itself for centuries. It is the prospect of irretrievable damage to the atmosphere, to the oceans, to Earth itself. What we are now doing to the world by degrading the land surfaces, by polluting the waters, and by adding greenhouse gases to the air at an unprecedented rate, all this is new in the experience of the Earth. It is mankind and his activities which are changing the environment of our planet in damaging and dangerous ways. The result is that change in future is likely to be more fundamental and more widespread than anything we have known hitherto. The environmental challenge, which confronts the whole world, demands an equivalent response from the whole world. Every country will be affected, and no one can opt out. Reason is humanity's special gift. It allows us to understand the structure of the nucleus. It enables us to explore the heavens. It helps us to conquer disease. Now we must use our reason to find a way in which we can live with nature and not dominate nature. We need our reason to teach us today that we are not, that we must not try to be, lords of all we survey. We are not the lords. We are the Lord's creatures, the trustees of this planet, charged today with preserving life itself, preserving life with all its mystery and all its wonder. May we all be equal to that task.
Social and environmental justice are two themes that feature highly in the environmental consciousness of the emerging world. Brazil, with the Amazon rainforest, is at the forefront of this. In December 1988, union leader and environmentalist Chico Mendes was assassinated in response to his successful campaigning for the protection of the rainforests around his hometown of Xapuri. The killing of Chico Mendes became a symbol of what is called the environmentalism of the poor. In Brazil, as well as in many other emerging economies, communities of rubber tappers, plant and nut gatherers, small fishermen, and other poor people are leading social and environmental resistance to the invasion of their spaces, which are seen by developers as frontiers of exploitation of natural resources. The nuclear disaster in Chernobyl was an event that has sent shockwaves around the globe, and its effects are still being felt to the present day. It was another nail in the coffin of the Soviet Union, because it exposed in a dramatic fashion the political, economic, and managerial failures of communism. In addition, it influenced the debate about nuclear power until the present day, and has delayed a nuclear renaissance until late into the first decade of the 21st century. The memories of Chernobyl came dramatically to the fore again with the nuclear disaster at the Fukushima nuclear power plant in Japan in 2011.
Una importante especie biológica está en riesgo de desaparecer por la rápida y progresiva liquidación de sus condiciones naturales de vida, el hombre. Ahora tomamos conciencia de este problema cuando casi es tarde para impedirlo. Es necesario señalar que las sociedades de consumo son las responsables fundamentales de la atroz destrucción del medio ambiente. Ellas nacieron de las antiguas metrópolis coloniales y de políticas imperiales que a su vez engendraron el atraso y la pobreza que ellos azotan a la inmensa mayoría de la humanidad. Con solo el 20% de la población mundial, ellas consumen las dos terceras partes de los metales y las tres cuartas partes de la energía que se produce en el mundo. Han envenenado los mares y ríos, han contaminado el aire, han debilitado y perforado la capa de ozono, han saturado la atmósfera de gases que alteran las condiciones climáticas, con efectos catastróficos que ya empezamos a padecer.
Senator Al Gore, author of the book Earth in the Balance, Ecology and the Human Spirit, what's it all about?
It's about a global ecological crisis that is, in my opinion, the most serious problem our world faces. It covers a lot of seemingly separate problems that are all part of the same underlying crisis. You know the old parable about the blind men and the elephant? One had a hold of a leg, the other the trunk, the other the tail, and it took them some time to realize that all of these separate parts were parts of the same large entity. When I first got involved in studying about problems relating to the environment, I had some similar difficulties. I saw the problem of ozone depletion and climate change, toxic waste disposal, the rainforest destruction, all as seemingly separate problems. I've now come to the conclusion that they are all symptoms of a deeper underlying crisis, which is a collision between our civilization as it's currently constituted and the ecological system of the Earth. The relationship between human beings and the Earth, as described in Earth in the Balance, has been changed profoundly in our lifetimes. The population explosion, new scientific and technological inventions that magnify the power we have to exploit the Earth, and a relatively new way of thinking that we are separate from the Earth, isolated individuals entitled to exploit it as much as we want. And that way of thinking is what really needs to be changed first. There's an old story about a science experiment involving a frog that's dropped in a pot of boiling water and it jumps right out. And then the same frog is put in a pot of lukewarm water, which is slowly brought to a boil. And the frog just sits there until it's rescued. The frog used to be boiled in the story, but I've learned how important it is to rescue the frog. But the point of that story is similar to the point of that graphic. The frog's nervous system is so primitive it needs a sudden jolt, a sudden contrast to make the connection between the changed circumstances and the danger it faces and what it needs to do to save itself. And we're like that frog in that when we see and hear these signals from around the world, the disappearance of the Aral Sea, the Love Canal, the garbage barge, the ozone hole, there's a very long list. The process of change they represent seems deceptively gradual in the context of a human lifetime, but in terms of history, it's actually very sudden. And the question is, when are we going to jump? When are we going to put two and two together and recognize that we have a responsibility to the future to do something about it?
Jumping to a chapter called Self-Stewardship, let me read a half a paragraph. 30-second television commercials and sophisticated public opinion polling can now calibrate and target a political message with frightening speed and accuracy, and they can do more to manipulate the opinions of voters in 2 weeks than all the speeches and debates and political organizations together can accomplish in 10 years. You really mean that? And if you do, why do you go through all the process of Senate debate and speeches on the road and all that if all you need is 30-second television commercials to get a message across?
Well, one of the reasons why the Senate floor is practically deserted during most speeches is that most of my colleagues know that what will matter at election time is the 30-second commercials. And what will not matter very much, usually, is the long speeches that are made on the substance of the issues that we're dealing with. I believe that this is God's earth. I believe that we belong here, but we have a responsibility to take care of it. And right now, there is environmental vandalism on a global scale. And many seem prepared to say, well, we were asleep. We didn't know what was going on. We didn't realize that we were causing such damage and allowing such damage to occur. I think we have a responsibility to something larger than ourselves to stop this environmental vandalism. The solutions are in Earth in the Balance and can be implemented as soon as a political consensus is formed. The real payoff, if you will, would be if it contributed in some small way to speeding up the formation of that political consensus that I talked about earlier, which convinces the political system to move. See, I think that change in our political system is like change in the global environment. It doesn't always occur slowly. It builds toward a threshold, and then the system adopts a new pattern. I think that when enough people become convinced that this has to be a priority, then the political system will start falling all over itself to come up with creative responses.
Global warming is the greatest single hoax ever perpetrated.
In what has become one of the greatest deceptions of our day, radical environmentalism is striving to put the world under its destructive control. This so-called green dragon is seducing your children in our classrooms and popular culture. Its lust for political power now extends to the highest global levels. And its twisted view of the world elevates nature above the needs of people, of even the poorest and the most helpless. With millions falling prey to its spiritual deception, the time is now to stand and resist.
I don't know, do we have to have a hurricane take out Miami and Shanghai to have everybody wake up? If it happened next year, it might be possible to still do that. What a hell of a way to run a planet.
In 1993, the Maastricht Treaty officially renamed the EEC as the European Union and introduced more cooperation between governments in areas like defense and justice.
With growing consumerism, chemicals have become an essential part of our everyday lives. The European Union has some of the toughest chemical safety laws in the world. The EU has already introduced a ban on harmful chemical substances, such as asbestos, even having to strip it out of its own Brussels headquarters.
In 2002, the euro was born. Currencies like French francs, Dutch guilders, and Italian lira all became history, and the euro became the currency of 12 EU countries, with only the UK, Denmark, and Sweden choosing to keep to their own currency. Countries continue to join the European Union, and in 2004, we saw the biggest ever single enlargement of the EU, when 10 countries joined.
European Union has been a terrific force for recognizing the value of nature. Let's not forget that something like now 20% of the whole land area of Europe has a kind of protection for nature.
Since it moved onto the political agenda in the late 80s, Europe has been leading international efforts to fight global warming. The EU has gone further than other signatories to the Kyoto Protocol, also wants to expand its groundbreaking emissions trading scheme to become a global carbon trading network. Launched in 2005, the innovative scheme allocates emission allowances to companies. They have an incentive to reduce their carbon output because they can then sell any allowances they don't need.
Europe must lead the world into a new, or maybe one should say, post-industrial revolution. The development of a low-carbon economy. We have already left behind our coal-based industrial past. It is time to embrace our low-carbon future.
Daniel Craig, actor, optimist.
Pele, athlete.
Robin, comedian, cyclist, frog, translator.
Harrison Ford, actor, conservationist, friend of frogs.
Just Stone, singer.
Tenzin Gyatso, symbol Buddhist monk.
William.
Harry.
Trying to preserve the rainforest.
For all of us.
Eric Schmidt, CEO of Google and rainforest enthusiast.
Steve Easterbrook, chief executive, McDonald's UK. And committed member, the Prince's Rainforest Project.
Hello, I'm Howard Stringer, Chairman and CEO of the Sony Corporation.
Michael Dell, entrepreneur, computer guy, frog advocate.
Ryan McBride, Managing Director of Amazon.co.uk.
Charlie Mayfield, Chairman of the John Lewis Partnership.
James Harding, Editor of the Times.
Christy Freeland, Financial Times.
Michael Chow, Nike, digital innovator, rainforest star.
Martha Lane Fox, dot-com dinosaur, more recently, frog lover.
Hello, my name is Richard Branson. I'm somewhat of an entrepreneur and an adventurer. And in my spare time, I love to turn frogs into beautiful women.
Rich Riley, head of Yahoo Europe, and
the father of four.
I'm Justin King, Chief Executive of Sainsbury's.
I'm Tom Boardman, Chief Executive of Nedbank in South Africa, committed to the environment, deeply concerned about climate change, and passionate about the Prince's Rainforest Project.
Dana Dunn, CEO, AOL Europe, proud father, proud husband, and frog lover.
Climate change is the greatest threat facing mankind. Every year, destruction of the Earth's rainforests releases more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere than all of the world's cars, planes, and ships put together. We must act now. Future generations are depending on us. Charles, Prince of Wales.
Kenneth Boulding, President Kennedy's environmental advisor 45 years ago, said something about this. Anyone who believes in indefinite growth in anything physical on a physically finite planet, he said, is either mad or an economist.
And this is why the notion of the green economy, the idea of decoupling economic growth from the consumption and the pollution footprint of our societies, has become such a critical imperative.
It raises living standards, it provides opportunities, and it shows very clearly that there is absolutely no contradiction between looking after our planet, looking after our environment, and overcoming poverty.
Some of the most promising innovation is happening in the area of clean energy technology. Technology that's creating jobs and making sure our planet is a healthier place to live that we can pass on to future generations.
是大力发展绿色经济。
The first step internationally is to make the effort to save the Earth's environment the central organizing principle for the post-Cold War world. Just as we bent every effort to defeat communism, now on a global basis, we have to develop this shared commitment to bend every effort towards saving the Earth's environment. That sounds and seems impossible to many right now. Just as a few years ago, it seemed impossible to expect the Soviet Union to disappear and all of Eastern Europe to be free and democratic and capitalist. But when enough people changed their way of thinking about communism, then what seemed impossible became imperative. Now, as more and more people are changing their way of thinking about the Earth's environment and our responsibility to it, what seems impossible will become imperative.
How do you hold the forests in common when every other force around you is trying to get you to privatize?
No, Pepsi, no cola!
We want living water!
Nice bubble. Lies which our poor people have been exposed to in my lifetime are just beyond anything that you think reasonable people could accept. But they did.
Most of the public does not know that their plastic materials are being made in petrochemical plants.
People think when they're drinking bottled water that they're getting a healthy product. They're not conditioned to think, well, maybe there's something in the plastic.
All along, I think the most useful and creative people, the very beginning, is the men who have said no. And many men have begun to say no again, and when the chorus gets loud enough, the people march.
Every social movement arrives at a certain point in history, a point it does not choose. But it has the power to make history.
have a dream that one day,
no matter how long it may take us,
as long as we have faith in our cause and an unconquerable willpower,
knowing that here on earth, God's work must truly be our own.
This is a time of challenge to our interest and our values. And it's a time to test our wisdom and our skills.
Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept.
We aren't going to let any dogs or water hoses turn us around. We aren't going to let any injunction turn us around.
I do not shrink from this responsibility. I welcome it.
With the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph. So help us God.
Lift up your heart. All will come right out of the depths of sorrow and of sacrifice. We'll be born again, the glory of mankind.
When I look at the direction, the future of humankind, I think there's lots of reason for optimism. You know, the world, despite all our problems, it really is getting better and better for most people every day.
One thing that makes me optimistic about humans as a species, we have this amazing ability, like no other species on Earth, of our ability, our intellect, and our ability to adapt to our environment. We can learn, and we can problem solve, we can communicate, and we can collaborate. That gives me hope that we will survive as a species well into the future.
Humans have used science and technology to make tremendous improvements in our lives. And my suspicions are that science and technology will continue to do that in the future. And that's why I have strong hope and belief that the future is going to be even better than it is today.
I'm glad we're not rolling the credits on human history. The story is still in progress. Let's hope that it's a big timeline and all we've chronicled here is a narrow slice. There's a great era yet to come.
There is a cycle of life and there's a cycle of every empire. We're born, we go through a period of glory, and we go through hibernation. And we will rise again, and we will fall again, but human resilience will last eternally.
The history of humankind is about interactions across oceans, across continents, across what we call races. Our DNA has been mixed because of our migration. We've progressed to the point where our Earth is, in a way, has shrunken over time. So that's allowed us even greater communication and cooperation and collaboration. And that is, I think, a hallmark of the ongoing saga of the human story.
I think that there is a way in which people are now more global citizens than they were perhaps in the past in terms of having a sense of being connected to the world, whether it be through technology or just through a greater sensibility, indeed, about the commonality of human struggles, human strivings, human desires.
Well, no human can survive completely isolated and alone. I think in many respects, the signal human experience is being part of a community, is being part of a group. It is in community that we can build something that is greater than ourselves. And I think that that is an essential part of the human experience.
Around you that you call life
was made up by people that were no smarter than you. And you can change it. You can influence it. You can build your own things that other people can use.
People want their technology to have a sense of humanity. They want it to understand me, you specifically.
We have 3 billion new minds coming online to work with us to solve the grand challenges. The rate at which the technology is getting faster is itself getting faster, to a point that we have the potential to create a world of abundance.